You know SOS, don't you? Three dots, three dashes, and three more dots. It's an easy enough signal to tap out in Morse code. It means save our souls or save our ship. The crew of the legendary Titanic had been desperately trying to send this signal for 2 hours, the night of April 14, 1912. There were other ships not too far from the spot where the iceberg took down the mighty Titan of the sea. But the call for help seemingly disappeared before it could reach them. The passenger ship SS Mount Temple did pick up a signal and tried to respond, but the Titanic never got the answer. So what was silencing the ship's cries for help? Some unknown Bermuda Triangle of the North Atlantic? Consider this. Eyewitnesses say the sky was painted with a brilliant aurora borealis that cold, fateful night. Beautiful, yes. But on that day, the Northern Lights may have sealed Titanic's fate for good. You see, the aurora borealis forms thanks to geomagnetic storms. Sounds complicated, but those are basically fluctuations in the Earth's magnetic sphere. And what causes those is the Sun itself. The magnetic sphere is like a protective bubble that surrounds our planet. It blocks harmful solar rays, winds, and other cosmic dangers from reaching us. Without it, life on our planet wouldn't be possible. Earth would look more like Mars. You also have it to thank for compasses pointing north. Experts know the Earth's magnetosphere affects navigational equipment, or disrupts it. Which brings us back to the Titanic. Recently, a published weather researcher named Mila Zenkova proposed a theory that solar flares, which provoked a geomagnetic storm, could have played a major role in the Titanic's untimely demise. Solar flares make themselves known on Earth all the time. Some people are especially sensitive to the magnetic storms they cause. These unlucky folks can feel weakness, fatigue, headaches, and even mood swings. On usual days, the pressure is the same on both sides. The magnetosphere blocks all the bad stuff, and we're all happy. But sometimes, explosions occur on the Sun. They can be massive, Earth-sized. These flares shoot out a wave of charged particles that collides with the magnetosphere at high speeds. Our protective bubble then goes on the defense. It shrinks, deforms, and pushes those particles toward the poles. Enter those brilliant lights dancing above the Titanic that night. In the north, we know it as Aurora Borealis. In the south, Aurora Australis, or the Southern Lights. When the magnetosphere pushes those solar and cosmic particles toward the poles, they collide with molecules of different gases. That's why you get the range of colors. For example, oxygen can be green or red, depending on the distance, and nitrogen is blue or purple. What multiple people saw that night was exactly this phenomenon, including the second officer from the rescue ship Carpathia. He wrote it down in the logbook before getting the distress call from the Titanic. But I'm getting ahead of myself. Auroras are a visible sign of a geomagnetic storm. Now, about navigational equipment. This applies to satellite and radio frequency devices. Remember, they didn't have iPhones back in the Titanic days, so the average person couldn't notice their gadgets going haywire. But navigational devices and wireless telegraph did exist and were actively used. Rewind back to the Middle Ages, when sailors noticed that, on some days, compasses wigged out. The arrows spun in all directions, and people back then had no idea why. It wasn't until the 18th century when French scientists found out that such problematic days occur at the same time as black spots appearing on the Sun. Solar flares. The mystery was solved. Now, the Titanic had the most advanced, well-known radio equipment at that time. They tested it thoroughly to make sure it worked for distances up to 2,000 miles away. Titanics passed them all. On April 10, 1912, the massive liner left Southampton and set off for New York. The very next day, the crew started getting the first reports of drifting icebergs and ice fields. They put dots on the map to mark the coordinates and let out a sigh of relief. All the troublesome spots were north of the Titanic's planned route. But after a couple of days, the warnings were moving farther and farther south, encroaching on the majestic ship. On April 14th, Captain Edward Smith decided to change course to the south in hopes of bypassing the ice. This ended up being a huge mistake. Enter the magnetic storm. If it was throwing the navigation equipment off, even by a tiny error of half a degree, the captain could have been mistakenly taking the ship right toward a cluster of icebergs. What's even worse, the radio operators ignored warnings coming from other ships. That, or they simply forgot to hand them over to the captain. As hired contractors from the radio company, they were more interested in transmitting paid telegrams from passengers on that luxurious liner. The radio transmitter kept going out of order that evening, probably because of all this private traffic. When it was finally fixed, operator Jack Phillips received another message from the SS Californian at 10:30 p.m. Their operator was trying to warn Phillips about the coordinates of drifting icebergs, but he paid them no attention. He was nervous and in a hurry. Was the magnetic storm to blame for his frayed nerves and bad mood? We can only speculate. But as you know, some people are more sensitive to these things. The weather was fine. The ocean was calm. The water was smooth as glass. Despite all the warnings, the ship continued to sail at a maximum speed of over 22 knots. An hour later, Titanic collided with the infamous iceberg. On April 15th at 12:14 a.m., in the middle of the night, Titanic's operator started to transmit the first emergency signals. The SS Californian was sailing just 20 miles from the Titanic. They could have easily come to a quick rescue. But 10 minutes before the disaster, the Californian's radio operator had gone to bed. He was the only one who understood Morse code on the ship. According to this new theory, the magnetic anomalies possibly blocked Titanic's messages to other ships. For example, the steamer SS La Providence didn't receive any signals from the sinking ship at all. Yet they were still getting transmissions from another giant, the Olympic, which was 500 miles from the Titanic. That night, the signals were acting strange. They simply got lost somewhere in space, or they were like a jumbled riddle, impossible to solve. The SS Mount Temple did get a message and rushed to Titanic's aid. But as fate would have it, the rescue ship got stuck in ice. She did arrive at Titanic's last known coordinates, but the luxury liner was nowhere to be seen. So were the coordinates accurate at all? The steamer Carpathia was about 60 miles away. At 12:30, their radio operator told the Titanic's crew they were rushing to help. The ship, famous for coming to the aid, Carpathia, was going full steam ahead. But here's the odd part. At first, they headed to the wrong spot. The magnetic storm could have thrown its equipment off. Good news is the steamer did end up reaching the right place when they saw the lifeboats full of passengers. Interestingly, once she reached land, the Carpathia didn't have any problems with her equipment. The blackout happened just around the wreckage site. The following investigation blamed radio amateurs for blocking signals. We now might know otherwise. Zinkova explains that at that time, they didn't know exactly how and to what extent the sun influences the Earth. No one could have guessed that the sun could tamper with these massive ships' navigational equipment, especially one that had the best of the best at the time. There's another theory that even the moon could have played a role. Some researchers claim that in January 1912, our natural satellite was closer to the Earth than usual. It caused very strong tides and raised the sea level. Every year, icebergs break away from Greenland and stop around Newfoundland. But not that year. The increased water flow pushed them further for 3 months. And come April, they were right in the way of transatlantic ships. Unfortunately, it was a recipe for disaster when it came to the mighty Titanic.